We have to close there. Thank you very much, Danny. Thank you. Great talk. There we go. So I'm going to talk about the influence of physical activity on vascular function in lifestyle-related disease. So Danny gave a very nice presentation on how arteries change in people with lifestyle disease, but I was just going to sort of address this in a slightly different way. So healthy blood vessels, why are they important? Well, one of the components out of two that I'm going to bring up is that, let's see, I use this one, is that elasticity of the arteries is an important aspect. This is affected by the arterial structure, which can change. And poor elasticity will increase your blood pressure and the work of the heart. And decreased elasticity or compliance is an aspect both in lifestyle-related disease, atherosclerosis, and aging. But the other aspect that I will talk more about is oxygen and nutrient supply to tissues. So this, of course, or can be affected by cardiac limitations, but also by the ability of the blood vessels here to dilate, so how much they can open up, which is what I will address, and then the capillarization in the muscle. And poor oxygen and nutrient supply is, on one hand, it can reduce the function of the muscle and therefore performance, but it's also an early indicator of, as similar to what Danny talked about, an early indicator of that the cardiovascular system is not as healthy as it should be, as the endothelium is not doing what it does in a healthy vessel. So, how can we determine vascular function in humans? Well, you heard Danny talk here about flow-mediated dilation, which is a very good clinical predictor of vascular function. You can also measure flow during exercise bouts in the arm or the leg, and passive movement flow is another possibility. We often use this one-leg knee extensor model that Bengt Saltin developed, and we look at leg vascular function, and that's what you'll see data from primarily today. Invasively, we can do function tests also here by infusion of vasoactive compounds such as ATP and acetylcholine and adenosine. We look at the response, how much blood flow is increased when we infuse these compounds. Or you can use inhibitors here of vasodilator systems to look at the functional role, for example, during exercise. So if blood flow is lowered, you know that there is a functional role of this vasodilator system. You can also look at molecular aspects, chemical aspects here, levels of vasoactive compounds in plasma and muscle, interstitial fluid, and expression of proteins related to vasodilator systems, such as enzymes and receptors. In a healthy, well-working system, you have the arterial or the vascular tone is regulated by, on one hand here, vasoconstriction, on the other hand, vasodilation. Vasoconstriction is primarily induced by sympathetic activity, but also circulating vasoconstrictors, whereas vasodilation is induced by locally formed vasodilators formed in the muscle, and functional sympatholysis, which is a metabolic modulation of sympathetic the sympathetic effect. So I'm going to talk about vasodilator systems, and Stefan Mortensen will talk about functional sympatholysis in his talk. So in the skeletal muscle, there are several sources of vasodilators. We have the erythrocytes that can produce ATP and nitric oxide. Endothelial cells that can produce nitric oxide and ATP and prostacyclin, as well as endothelial-derived hyperpolarizing factor, which is more a sort of a concept, but compounds. Skeletal muscle cells can produce NO and ATP, and then adenosine can be produced as soon, extracellularly, as soon as you have ATP, either in plasma or in interstitium. So there are a number of compounds, there are a number of cellular sources, but we also have a number of mechanisms by which vasodilators are produced. So you need a signal in order to increase the production of vasodilators. So here we have shear stress, which is the mechanical impact that blood flow exerts on the endothelial layer in the lumen of the vessel. We have oxygen desaturation of the hemoglobin molecule in the erythrocytes. So as the red blood cell passes through the arterial and through the capillary, oxygen is offloaded, and at the same time you have a production of vasodilators. Chemically mediated is any compound that's in the interstitial fluid or in the plasma, for example, can induce the production of vasodilators. Muscle contraction per se, and then we have conductive vasodilation here, which is the electrical signaling in the endothelial layer, which actually can lead to upstream vasodilation. So you see that this is a complex process with many players that regulate ultimately your vascular tone and how much oxygen and nutrients that is delivered to the skeletal muscle. So I'm going to bring up three things. Here, vascular function assessed by infusion of vasodilators, vasodilator, vasoconstrictor systems, and then blood pressure. And of course, the point here will be to look at effects of training. So when we assess vascular function by infusion of vasodilators, what we do is we use compounds such as these, acetylcholine, ATP, and adenosine. They will act on receptors of the endothelium and lead to the production of compounds such as nitric oxide, prostaglandin, and EDHF. So in reality, when we are fusing acetylcholine or ATP or adenosine, what we're looking at is the endothelial cell's ability to respond to these compounds or mediators of vasodilation and the cell's ability to form these vasodilators, leading then to vasodilation, which is what we measure. So here we're looking at a study on individuals with moderate essential hypertension, and we're comparing them to normotensive. We're infusing three concentrations here into the femoral artery, as you see here. And the white bars are the normotensive, and the black bars are the hypertensive individuals. We're looking here at vascular conductions, which is how open the arterial system is, which corresponds to the level of blood flow, you could say. And although this is not significant, there is a clear trend for that the hypertensive individuals respond less, so have a reduced vascular function. In the forearm, this effect is clear. There's a difference there if you look at the forearm, and in the leg, it's not as evident. The picture is similar if you look in individuals with type 2 diabetes. Here is healthy controls and individuals with type 2 diabetes, and we see that there's a non-significant but still a trend for a lower response in individuals with type 2 diabetes. However, if you look at ATP and adenosine infusion, you see that there is a clear reduction in the response to both ATP and adenosine. These are studies by Pia Tanning et al. She's done two studies on diabetics. And I should say that, in the forearm, there is a showing a reduced response to acetylcholine. So there appears to be a difference between the leg and the arm. We always use the leg, so we generally actually see less differences. So in Copenhagen, we are doing a rather large study on women because not that much is known about women and cardiovascular disease. We're looking at different groups, but one of the aspects we're looking at is the effect of menopause. So we are comparing premenopausal and postmenopausal women. We've tried to age match them pretty well, so it's only about 4 years of difference in order to avoid the age effect. And the point with the menopause is, of course, that estrogen has a protective effect on the cardiovascular system. So this protective effect is there for about 50 years, and then all of a sudden you lose your estrogen, and the cardiovascular system goes downhill. And as a matter of fact, what we see here, which is quite interesting, is that if you can compare premenopausal to postmenopausal women, there is already, after 4 years, a difference in the response to acetylcholine. So they already there have a reduced vascular function. I also wanted to point out that in aging, we also see a decline in vascular function. Here we have acetylcholine. Here we have age. Here are three sedentary groups with different ages. And you see how the response goes very much downhill with age. These two points represent trained groups. I'll come back to that. So let's look at the effect of training then on these same individuals that you saw before. So I should say that I'm going back to the same studies all the time. I'm just addressing different aspects here to give a sort of, put them together. So here we're looking at the effect of training. And what we find here is that in the hypertensive individuals, training has a good effect on vascular function. It improves vascular function, something that we cannot see in the normotensives. So this is 8 weeks of interval cycle exercise, kind of spinning type of exercise. And we don't have data for diabetics in the leg, but this study by Majorana and Danny Green from 2001 shows that 8 weeks of combined aerobic and resistance training here improves vascular function as assessed by acetylcholine infusion. In our postmenopausal women, we had a pretty disappointing finding. It's still an ongoing study, this, but there does not seem to be a difference in the response to acetylcholine in these women with training. So here we've trained in 12 weeks, pretty high intensity interval cycling, spinning exercise, and yet you see there is no effect of training. And we're not quite sure of this finding, but it may be, and there are indications in the literature, that it could be due to the fact that they're lacking estrogen, and at least in this early stage after menopause, that estrogen is needed to see improvements. What about the aged? Well, here we have three groups, a young group, an aged trained group, and an aged untrained group. This trained group is very well trained. The good thing that we can see in this graph is that whereas the young have a good response, the age untrained have almost no response to acetylcholine. But the good point here is that if you've been training most of your life, this reduction is not as severe. So the point is that it's not about aging per se, maybe, at least not all of it, but it's rather many years of inactivity. So I'll have key points to each part here. So the results from these arterial infusions is that lifestyle-related disease and aging is associated with reduced vascular function, and physical activity can maintain and improve this vascular function. So let's look at more mechanistic chemical aspects here, vasodilator or vasoconstrictor systems. What's underlying these effects that we see? So this is a study on individuals with mild essential hypertension. And we're looking at endothelial nitric oxide synthase, which produces NO and is believed to be one of the key enzymes in cardiovascular health. We're measuring total protein levels of ENOS. And you see here first that the hypertensives have much less ENOS, the normotensives, suggesting that they have a reduced ability to form nitric oxide. So it's an important aspect. But, a bit disappointing again, if you train these individuals for 4 months, you do not see actually an increase in ENOS. I should say that other studies and other individuals show that ENOS can be increased, but in this study, in these essential hypertensive individuals, we actually don't see that. But we have another interesting finding in essential hypertension, and that is the quality of endothelial nitric oxide synthase. So in a normal state, ENOS is a dimer. It produces NO from L-arginine, but it can be monomerized, so divided into monomers, whereby ROS is formed instead of NO. And this is a detrimental aspect of ENOS because now you're not only producing NO, but you're also producing ROS, which binds rapidly with NO and reduces the bioavailability. So there are two aspects of this that are not good. And what we can see here is that the ENOS monomer number in relation to total ENOS is actually not different between the two groups here, but reduced with training. So it could indicate that the function of ENOS is actually better after training, whether you're normotensive or hypertensive. We've also looked at ENOS phosphorylation, but we don't see, which indicates activity state of the enzyme, we don't see differences with training. But I find this a pretty interesting finding. So this study by Beck and co-workers here showed that both endurance and strength training can lead to improvements in vasodilators. So here we have resistance training, endurance training, and before and after training, we have nitric oxide metabolites indicating increased NO formation, prostacyclin, it's also a vasodilator, and here a vasoconstrictor. And you can see that both resistance and endurance training increases the level of nitric oxide metabolites and prostacyclin and reduces the level of endothelin in the vasoconstrictor. So the balance between vasodilators and constrictors is improved towards vasodilation. We also have data on plasma endothelium from essential hypertension here, and it's striking how big a difference there is before training in hypertensive compared to normotensives, much higher levels, and how this is normalized. So endothelin might actually be a rather important player in hypertension and lifestyle-related disease. So another vasoconstrictor is thromboxane, which sort of plays together with prostacycline, so both are formed in the arachidonic acid pathway. Here we have measured thromboxane in the muscle interstitium by microdialysis. So if you're not aware of this method, it's just a plastic tubing that we put through the leg. And this tubing has a dialysis membrane in the middle. You perfuse it, and you can collect your sample and get an idea of how much of a compound there is in the muscle extracellular fluid. And a striking finding here is that the thromboxane levels at rest are much lower in hypertensives after training compared to before. So again, a reduction in vasoconstrictors, which is likely to be a good thing for vascular health. So key points here, measurements of vasoactive systems show that lifestyle-related disease is associated with an increased level of vasoconstrictors, including endothelin 1, and that physical training leads to an improved balance between vasodilators and vasoconstrictors towards vasodilation. So the final thing I wanted to bring up was the effect of training on blood pressure and look at different types of training in the same study and how they affect blood pressure. So this is the same study as you saw before by Beck, and it actually shows that both endurance training and resistance training reduces blood pressure about 7-8 millimeters of mercury. So here we have 8 weeks of either endurance or in this resistance training. You see it decreases both in systolic and diastolic blood pressure in both, and a total reduced mean arterial pressure. Here we have 12 weeks of intense interval cycle exercise in our menopausal, postmenopausal women. And although we didn't really see an effect on vascular function, you can actually see that there is a reduction in blood pressure in these women. I should say that the effect of training when we're training the premenopausal seems to be a greater effect in these women, also on this parameter, on VO2 max and so forth. So the postmenopausal women are responding less, but they seem to be having a reduced blood pressure. Here we have more light exercise combined with resistance training, so kind of the intervention you would maybe recommend to you know, your mother or whatever to reduce blood pressure. And that's actually working also. You have a 7 millimeter of mercury reduction also with this intervention. This is a little longer, but less intense. And then finally, this study shows from Anderson shows that football training is a quite good way of reducing blood pressure. Here we have 9 millimeters of mercury reduction in blood pressure individuals with essential hypertension. So all these studies are on hypertensives. So my point is here that it seems to be that it doesn't really matter what kind of training intervention you would recommend to someone. If they have elevated blood pressure, all of them work, at least if you're not trained from the beginning. So this is quite good. So the thing to focus on, I think, is to find something that you can endure and find fun. Maybe football or maybe some other thing, but that I think it's really good to see that regardless of what you do, you can lower blood pressure. So that's it. Light to moderate intensity exercise, high intensity intermittent exercise, and team sports all reduce blood pressure. So with that, I would like to acknowledge my coworkers here and the funding bodies. Thank you very much. Questions? Sorry, I'm my own chair. It's no good. Yeah, you can ask one. There's one over there.
Oh, great. Oh, thanks. Thanks. Since this work. Okay. You're just talking to it. Okay. Ilva, the pre-postmenopausal women thing is really interesting. Do you think you need estrogen to enable improvement?
I hope not.
Because, you know, we've been through that thing with hormone replacement and around a couple of times now. But is it something that we need to go back to and look at, you know, the timing hypothesis? What do you think about that?
I think that, Doug Seals has some data showing that if you give postmenopausal women estrogen, they respond better to training in terms of vascular function. I'm hoping that you don't need estrogen, because estrogen supplementation, as you know, is not the best thing maybe for all people. I'm thinking that it could be that we're taking them so soon after they lose estrogen, and kind of hoping that if you train farther on, you know, later on, that you will get better improvements. Otherwise, it's probably just a matter of time. It'll take, just like in diabetes and hypertension, so forth, it seems to be that it takes longer time to get your improvements. But I can't answer that. It's something that we want to look into, definitely, because I think it's an important thing. It's disappointing if you train and you don't see the improvements you want to see. That shouldn't deter people from training. So it's important to understand what's going on. Thank you.
I'll follow it up. So the estrogen changes with age in women, but testosterone changes in age with men. And a lot of middle-aged men, particularly central adiposity, have low testosterone levels. What do we know about the combined effects of exercise and testosterone on arteries?
Don't know. Do you?
No, I thought you might know.
I'm looking at women.
Salomon did some studies in transgender, and in both directions, transitioning, and showed some interesting stuff with testosterone that seemed to, I think, for recollection, improved arterial function measured by flow-mediated dilation. But I don't think there's been any studies looking at the sort of invasive stuff that you do, which is much more mechanistically tight.
But I think that there have been some studies on individuals with prostate cancer, right? Where they actually do see some pretty better improvements than you would think without testosterone. So it's kind of interesting, yeah.
Yeah, that's an interesting point, actually, because there's also some evidence that androgen deprivation therapy improves vascular functions.
Yeah, that's right.
It's very complicated. The interactions between the hormones, I think, are probably something we need to start looking at.